Real Life Habits for Success with Jeffrey Benjamin, Sundays at 9:30 a.m. on 99.1 FM Talk and streaming online at 99.1fmtalk.com. BreakthroughTraining.com.
Hi, I'm Jeffrey Benjamin, and you're listening to Real Life Habits for Success. Some of the topics you can catch right here are living an accountable life, strengthening your leadership, building an unstoppable team, achieving your goals, maximizing your time. These are just some of the topics you can catch right here. And I'm always asking you to take action on this information, to do something with it, because knowing this information won't change or improve the quality of your life. You've got to do something with it in order to get a result. And in the studio today, I have the author of Compete and Empower, Increasing Wealth and Fostering Freedom. And his name is Brian Sear, and he's an investor in emerging country businesses and early stage ventures. He's a member of the Sear Angels and is president of VenRaD, a venture research and development consultancy founded by him in 1985. Brian brings a unique perspective to strategy that can solve the polarization holding America back from its destiny. And I'm excited to hear about your book, Compete and Empower. So congratulations. Thank you for coming in the studio today.
Thank you, Jeff. It's a privilege to be here, and I'm very excited about it. I've looked at some of your material, and I think it's great, and so I look forward to sharing about my book.
So why did you write the book? What's it all about?
A little bit of background, and then I'll give you the real bottom line reason. First of all, you know, coming from England as an immigrant in 1960, I had the good fortune to both observe America and participate in the American miracle for 50 years. It was a wonderful journey of discovery. Along the way, I realized America must have something special, something really profound, to have achieved so much in so little time. What incredible results, America. Since the Declaration of Independence from Britain, my old country, in 1776 has grown from 4 million people and a tiny share of world GDP to over 300 million people, a 14 trillion economy, and 28% of the world market.
And that is amazing.
It is amazing. I did notice, however, that the last 100 years we've been losing our way. In fact, the results have got lesser and our citizens have become conflicted. After 150 years of unbridled growth and success, we became complacent. We compromised in good faith and allowed a cancer to metastasize in our community of great Americans. During the last century, we voted for elite career politicians who were squandering America's wealth to get votes and stay elected. They pander to the people under a cloak of social justice. They use the law to tax and regulate and devise schemes like unemployment, Social Security, Medicare, to entrap the people in a false sense of security. Think how great we could have been with citizen politicians who kept their oath of office and went to Washington as public servants.
And I want those citizen politicians back, Brian.
I do too.
I want them back.
Let me now talk about the specific reason I did write the book. In 2007, I was successfully investing in China companies, some large and some small. It was selective. And I was doing very well. And I realized that I couldn't just rely on the press. I had to go and visit. I visited six cities from Beijing, Shanghai, all the way to Shenzhen and Hong Kong. And I came away with an incredible impression of how the Chinese people were embracing free market capitalism, and they really believed in it, and they were given the freedoms to exercise it, I think, in a better way than we are in America today.
And I saw the same thing when I was in China as well, so you're absolutely right on.
That's great news. So I've got a supporter for the theory here. Mm-hmm. Returning home to the U.S., I realized our leaders were already defeated. They're calling this century the China century. They've already decided that we can't beat China, which, because of my business experience, I know we can continue to lead the world. We need to compete with other nations and empower them to grow toward prosperity. It's better than appeasing dictatorial governments who are conquering and oppressing their people. So the book was born, and I felt compelled to show a way forward.
And so what's one of the main themes, or what's some of the main message, and how's it a little bit different, Brian?
First of all, I'm going to make this claim. America has done more to improve the prosperity of planet Earth than any other nation. Mm-hmm. And I really believe that, sincerely. A majority of Americans believe in the principles crafted by our founding fathers in the Constitution. Many are passionate about them, like I am, but some are not. It's hard to believe that there are people today that believe America's been doing the wrong thing. Anyway, compete and empower explores the economic benefits of capitalizing on our human potential and provides a rational basis for America's greatness. There are three foundations that support our society like a three-legged stool, all unnecessary to provide a secure seat from which we can prosper. The first one is self-reliance. It's human nature, and it nurtures the human spirit. The second one, which is very American, is the Constitution. It puts the people in charge and nurtures liberty and freedom. And finally, there's a somewhat unknown leg of the stool, and it's called natural competition, introduced by Bruce Henderson in the early 60s. It's the nature of business competition, and it's self-regulating. These three foundations have created a nation that has changed the world we live in for the better.
All right, so share with us some of the results that have been achieved from these principles.
Okay, so thank you. Let's look at some of these results. Well, I'm going to go back in time. From caveman to current man, human beings as individuals and entrepreneurs have invented, developed, and produced products and services that have increased the wealth for many. As individuals and self-reliant people, we get an excellent grade, an A++. However, in 7,000 years of recorded history, human beings, that's you and me, have made a mess of developing societies and nations. We get a failing grade, an F. Until 1800, the world of nations was in a poverty trap. That's the way it's described. All nations ruled by conquerors, dictators, kings, emperors, and power-hungry elites. These rulers confiscated the wealth for themselves and enslaved the people. GDP and wealth grew at less than 0.2%, like 0.1%. It wasn't going anywhere. Some would even say that peasants in 1750 England existed like cavemen. From 1800 on, the world GDP grew over 10 times faster, at over 2%. Some say it was the Industrial Revolution, man's inventions. I agree, man's inventions were a major factor, but I believe Americans, their pioneering spirit, and their constitution committed to free market capitalism made all the difference. From 1965 on, world GDP grew at 5%, if you can believe that. And some say it was the information age. But I believe it was companies that executed Bruce Henderson's principles of natural competition, and it made all the difference. And then, would you believe, why did we run into trouble in the last century? Along came Marx. This was a golden opportunity for elites to take power from the kings, conquerors, and imperialists of the past, and so we had a century of executions, wars, and the killing of millions of people. It was a terrible century in that sense. Today, there are 200 nations with up to 1 million elites governing our nations. Their performance is pitiful. 5.5 billion people out of 6.8 exist in poverty.
That just blows my mind too, Brian. And those numbers are staggering. So we only have about a minute left. What can we do as citizens?
Okay, well, the first thing we have to do is we've got to accept responsibility that we allowed these career politicians to be there. We look the other way. But more importantly, then, if we recognize we're responsible, we've got to embrace a mission that by 2020, 2025, we will recreate our country as our founders intended it to be. So how are we going to do that? Well, I think there's already a quiet revolution that's taking place. There are a lot of angry people out there. They're convinced that we're going in the wrong direction. I call this an open source patriot network that will transform the country in the next 2 or 3 years. We have to educate the silent majority. We have to recruit and develop constitutional conservative citizens to replace all the current career politicians. Whether you're Republican or Democrat, I don't care. All these career politicians have to go. Now, there are a number of things we can require them to pledge to do, all of which are in the book and would help us, transform us, and take us back to the Constitution.
All right, good. So how does someone find your book? How does someone buy your book, Brian?
Buy my book by going on my website, briansear.com, www.briansear.com, and you'll be able to find out about some of the things I'm doing to teach people I mentor, and also the essence of the book, and you can buy the book right there from Amazon, Barnes & Noble, or any of the other major sources.
Brian, thank you so much for coming in and sharing your wisdom on your book, Compete and Empower, Increasing Wealth and Fostering Freedom. And if you have any questions or comments, send me an email, results@breakthroughtraining.com.